Hello, everyone, and welcome to the National Museum of the American Indians Professional Development Series, Native New York in Your Classroom. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Amy Temerance, and I'm the lead cultural interpreter at the museum. Native New York in Your Classroom is a free four-part webinar series designed for education professionals who teach about the Native nations of New York State. And this series is also tied to an upcoming exhibition called Native New York, which will be on view at our museum in New York City in 2021. We'll be posting a link to where you can learn more about this exhibition in our chat today. In today's webinar, we'll be focusing on the museum's digital lesson called Early Encounters in Native New York. Did Native People Really Sell Manhattan? This is a lesson designed to complement fourth and fifth grade social studies curriculum in New York City and New York State. I'd now like to introduce the facilitators for today's session, Myra Hernandez and Dr. Johanna Gorelick. Myra is the lead curriculum writer for the NK360 digital lesson Early Encounters in Native New York, and Johanna is the education manager at the National Museum of the American Indian.
Hello. My name is Johanna Gorelick, and I am the education manager at the National Museum of the American Indian, as Amy mentioned. I welcome you to the fourth part of our webinar series, Native New York in Your Classroom. As with our in-person programs, we generally start with a land acknowledgement. Feeling a sense of belonging is important for each and every one of us. Families, friends, shared language groups, people from our homelands or countries of origin share a sense of belonging. Culture is often the way that we express that belonging. We gratefully acknowledge the Native people on whose ancestral homelands we gather, as well as the diverse and vibrant Native communities who make their home here today. This is our museum's land acknowledgement. I am in New York City on the ancestral homeland of the Lenape people. For many Indigenous people, belonging is deeply tied to ancestral homelands through relationships with the environment, memories, and cultural experiences lived over millennia. In the United States, people are increasingly doing land acknowledgments, which can be spoken or written, and are meant to recognize that Indigenous people are the original stewards of the lands on which we now live and work. These acknowledgments should be motivated by genuine respect for and support of Native peoples. Acknowledging original Indigenous inhabitants is often complex, though, because of the centuries of displacement experienced by many Native peoples. Many Native groups have been removed or relocated and adapted to new places and environments, such as cities, rural areas, and reservation communities. Land acknowledgments are the first step in creating collaborative, accountable, and respectful relationships with Indigenous nations and communities. Many of you may already be doing land acknowledgments in your classroom. For those who are looking for some guidance, the museum has developed a one-page handout, which will be placed in the chat and will also be sent out to each of the attendees after today's webinar. As I mentioned earlier, I work at the National Museum of the American Indian, which is part of the Smithsonian Institution, a complex of museums, libraries, a zoo, and research centers. We have two exhibition locations, one in Washington, D.C. on the National Mall, which you see here on your left, and one in New York City, which is where I'm based, which is in Lower Manhattan. Our collection is housed at the Cultural Resources Center in Suitland, Maryland. One of the most common questions that we receive from teachers, students, and our general visitors is why we are called the National Museum of the American Indian. The term American Indian is a general way to describe Indigenous cultures and communities of the Western Hemisphere. There are nearly 600 federally recognized tribes in the United States alone, each with its own history, social and political structure, cultural practices, and language. Since our museum represents Native people from the entire hemisphere, you can understand why a term like American Indian or Native American is inadequate to describe the vast diversity that exists among and between Indigenous communities. Some people have a preference for a non-specific term, but for the purposes of today's talk, we'll be using both terms Native American and American Indian interchangeably when speaking generally about Indigenous people. We created a one-page handout entitled The Impact of Words, which we will post a link to, central to our mission, our strategic partnerships with Native people and allies. Collaborations with classrooms across the country is key to our collective efforts to teach students more complete narratives about Native Americans and advances our goal to foster a more informed understanding of Native peoples. We feel honored to work in education and with committed educators like yourselves. The work of the National Education Initiative is at the heart of the work that we do to make social justice rights become a reality. So let's talk about our plan for today. In this webinar, you will preview the museum's newest online lesson that was developed in support of the upcoming exhibit called Native New York. The lesson, Early Encounters in New York, Did Native People Really Sell Manhattan?, takes a look at the early 17th century relationship between Native people and the Dutch. The lesson is available online on the museum's website. It's created as part of the museum's National Education Initiative, Native Knowledge, or NK360. And if you attended last week's session, you heard Ed Shubman speak about NK360 and our efforts to create educational materials, virtual student programs, and teacher training such as this that incorporates Native narratives, more comprehensive histories, and accurate information to enlighten and inform teaching and learning about Native Americans. NK360 challenges common assumptions about Native people and offers a view that includes not only the past, but also the vibrancy of Native people and cultures today. So today's session will be led by Myra Hernandez, the lead curriculum developer for this lesson. She will be modeling how it might work, how you might teach it with your students, and your full participation is strongly encouraged. Lesson will take approximately 60 minutes, and we hope to provide you the full scope of the approaches that you might take with it. So now I'd like to introduce you to Myra Hernandez, who will guide us through today's lesson.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Myra, and I'm excited to present NMAI's NK360 online lesson, Early Encounters in Native New York. In today's webinar, we will walk through the online lesson that provides Native perspectives, images, documents, and other sources to help students and teachers understand how the 17th century fur trade brought together two cultures, one Native and the other Dutch, with different values and ideas about exchange. Before diving into the online lesson, let's take a look at what went into its development. The lesson goals are the following: to provide educators and students with a more comprehensive study of the fur trade through an exploration of differing cultural value systems and Native views regarding early exchange interactions between Native New Yorkers and Dutch fur traders. To understand that Native people were active participants in the 17th century's fur trade. To understand that the fur trade depended on establishing both economic and diplomatic relationships based on Native practices of giving and exchange. And lastly, to examine how different cultural worldviews regarding land informed land exchanges. We are asking that students use these understandings to argue whether or not the land exchange that took place on Manhattan in 1626 was really a land sale or not. The lesson revolves around the skills outlined in the Common Core Standards and the C3 Framework Dimension Standards and implements an inquiry-based approach to learning. We were fortunate to have the authors of the C3 framework, Kathy Swan and John Lee, review and provide feedback in the development of this inquiry. The content and themes are highly influenced by the National Council for the Social Studies and by NMAI's own framework for essential understandings about American Indians. In webinar 3 of this series, NMAI's Ed Shootman provided an introduction to Native Knowledge 360 and the framework for essential understandings about American Indians. For those of you who were unable to attend, a recording of webinar 3 will be made available. The lesson consists of supporting questions, featured sources, and performance tasks necessary for students to construct arguments that pertain to the compelling question, did Native people really sell Manhattan? Regarding pacing, the lesson can be completed sequentially over 3 to 5 days, although each performance task can be used as standalone lessons. The lesson focuses on the Lenape and Mohican, native New Yorkers who traded with the Dutch in the early years of the 17th century fur trade. There are many native nations of the New York region. These nations are of diverse cultures and their histories are extensive. This lesson is not intended to be a comprehensive study of all New York native nations and their respective histories and cultures. Nor does it study the entire fur trade, which lasted approximately 150 years. The lesson looks at one connection that many Native New York nations share, cultural value systems that emphasize social reciprocity and exchange as a means of establishing and maintaining relationships. In the development of the lesson, community interviews and reviewers included enrolled members of the Stockbridge, Munsee, Band of Mohican Indians, the Delaware Tribe of Nations, and Lenape. Audio pronunciations were provided by members of the Shinnecock, Uncochug, and Mohican Nations. In just a few minutes, we will watch an opening video addressing how the fur trade brought together Native people and Europeans, two dissimilar cultures that looked and spoke very differently from one another. To introduce the video, the online lesson provides a fun activity called Meeting of Strangers. For this activity, students are given 1 minute to learn as much as they can about their classmate without speaking. Considering that students aren't able to use words to share about themselves, they have to rely on cultural similarities, body language, and shared experiences to decipher meaning about their classmate. Unlike our ability to rely on shared experiences and similarities, the first encounters between Native people and Europeans didn't have the same advantages. So to begin our inquiry, we will first watch a video that explains what brought Native people and the Dutch together in Native New York. Some background info on a figure we're going to hear about in the video, English explorer Henry Hudson. Hired by the Dutch East India Company, a private Dutch corporation, Hudson set out to find a sea route to Asia. The Netherlands, like other nascent European countries, were in pursuit of riches in order to fund imperial interests. Although the lesson does not focus on Henry Hudson, the video serves to introduce Hudson's role in the Dutch decision to trade and later settle in New York in the 17th century. I'm going to ask you to participate. While you all watch the video, try to identify information that explains why beaver fur brought Native people and the Dutch together in Native New York.
We missed you last week. Where'd you go?
I was in Manhattan with my parents.
By Manhattan, you mean New York City?
Sure. New York City has 5 boroughs. Manhattan is just one of the boroughs, so you could say I was in Manhattan in New York City.
Right. Well, how was it?
It was great. There's a lot of things in New York named after some guy named Hudson. Hudson River, Henry Hudson Bridge, Hudson Yards.
Do you know who he was?
Probably some ex-mayor or politician or something.
Well, actually, he was a British navigator who was hired by the Dutch East India Company to find a shortcut to Asia. His ship was called the Half Moon. He sailed across the Atlantic Ocean and ended up in the river, which now bears his name.
Did he find his way to Asia?
Nope. He traveled up the river to what is now Albany, before he realized it would not get him to Asia. But along the way, he met many Native Americans.
How do you know that?
Because of Robert Jewett, Hudson's shipmate. Jewett kept a journal about their trip.
Did the Native Americans also keep a journal?
No, they didn't. That's why it's difficult to know what their side of the story really was.
So what did Jewett write about?
Well, he described seeing lots of Native people who looked and spoke very differently from Hudson's crew. Some Native people in canoes came on board with things like food and furs that Hudson and his crew traded for, with stuff they brought from Europe. Hudson's crew was particularly excited about the beaver furs, because there was a fashion craze in Europe at that time. Everyone wanted a beaver felt hat.
A beaver felt hat? Seriously?
Yes. They were so popular in Europe that they nearly wiped out the entire beaver population. When Hudson returned with beaver furs, Dutch traders decided to return to the area to see how many beaver furs they could bring back to Europe.
Seriously? They came to New York for beaver furs?
Yes. At first, they just traded with the native people for furs. But after a while, wealthy Dutch merchants created the Dutch West India Company and began making plans to stay in New York so they could have control of the fur trade. They built trading houses and made this area their home. They even built a fort on the tip of Manhattan to defend the area from European competitors.
So the Dutch got furs. What did the native people get in return?
The native people who lived in the area got metal kettles, beads, cloth, and other things. Many kettles were broken up and the metal was made into other tools and even ornaments. European goods were also traded for wampum, a shell bead that was traded among native people in the area before European arrival.
What did they do with wampum?
Wampum is still made and used today. But in the 17th century, it was used as jewelry, also for ceremonies, and it was even used to record important events. In fact, while there was a beaver hat craze in Europe, there was a wampum craze in what is now New York. The Dutch learned how much native people wanted wampum. They started making it themselves to trade to the native people. The Dutch used wampum as money, but native people never considered it that way.
So where are the Dutch today? And why don't I see Native Americans when I go to New York?
Well, after a while, the relationship wasn't so great between the native people, the Dutch, and the other Europeans who came later. The Dutch saw trade and exchange a lot differently than the native people who lived here. And there actually are native people who live and work in and around New York today. You might not notice, though, because they don't look the way they do in our school books. Many Dutch are also still here. You could see many Dutch names all around the city, like Harlem, Bowery, and the Bronx.
Wow, that's nuts. So people like the Dutch and other Europeans started coming to New York for beaver furs and then never left?
Yeah, kinda.
That's why Hudson's name is everywhere.
Yep. And if you look throughout the city, you'll see images of beavers everywhere, including on the New York City flag.
This is the part of the story you never learn in school. I can't believe that a fashion craze started what is now known as New York.
Great. So what did the video reveal? In the chat, I'm going to ask that you all share what information you identified that explains why beaver fur brought Native people and the Dutch together in Native New York. So let's hear, what did you find? So what information did the video reveal about what brought these two distinct cultures together? You can write your ideas in the chat. So resources and fashion, making money. So it started off as a trading relationship. The Dutch loved hats made out of beaver fur. Trade, supply and demand. Native Americans were already trapping beavers and the Europeans wanted the beaver fur. There was a fashion craze in Europe for beaver fur hats. People want to look good and it leads to unusual relationships. Great. Well, thank you for participating. So this, we're going to move on to the next slide. In the video, we heard that Native accounts and perspectives are often left out of history. Native histories were maintained through oral traditions and mnemonic devices, such as wampum belts, and are reflected in the material culture. The focus on written accounts and documents over other forms of communication has had tremendous implications on how history has been shaped and remembered. Much of what historians know regarding life in and around the Hudson River Valley during the fur trade has come from Native oral traditions, Dutch documents, and archaeological material culture. The first supporting question in the lesson, why did exchange matter to Native people and the Dutch, provides sources and information that builds understanding on the following. Native nations of the northeastern Atlantic coast have engaged in exchange for centuries as a means of social cohesion. The fur trade brought together two distinct cultures with very different value systems. To ground us in the region explored in the lesson, we have this map of Native New York circa 1615. As mentioned earlier, this lesson focuses on the Lenape and Mohican. What needs to be stressed is that New York and the surrounding regions were also home to many diverse Native nations and groups during this time. Once again, I'm going to ask you all to participate. Using the prompt, I see, I wonder, share your observations and questions regarding the map in the chat. For example, using the prompt, I might share, I see color territories. I wonder what they represent. When you're ready, you can start writing your responses in the chat. So what do you see and what do you wonder? And this is an opening activity we suggest teachers do with their students as well. I see Mohican and Lenape. I wonder how the borders were established. I see Fort Nassau. I wonder why it's there. Great. Observations. I wonder what happens in the overlap area. I see two colors for different tribes. I wonder what life was like when those two colors mixed in the Hudson River Valley. I see Lenape. I wonder what was their previous name. I see the Hudson River. I wonder how far north it goes. Great observations. I wonder what happens. Oh, I see the Hudson River. I wonder if the Lenape called it that. Great. As seen on the map, Lenape and Mohican territories consisted of loose boundaries, which often blended into each other. For Native people, there was no formal sense of land ownership. Instead, land and its resources were commonly held. Territory was defined primarily by what resources the group needed and where those could be obtained. Vast networks of ties within and amongst communities allow the Lenape and Mohican to move in and around their homelands as opportunities to seasonal resources presented themselves. Neighboring communities shared a long history of trade, allowing for the exchange of resources, information, and technology. Along with providing access to goods, the reciprocal exchange of items served to establish alliances and maintain relationships and balance amongst the many different Native communities who inhabited the region. Now let's learn about the people of the fur trade and Native New York addressed in the lesson. The Lenape are the original inhabitants of Manhattan, the Lenape word for Manhattan. The Lenape called the island and the surrounding area home for centuries prior to the arrival of Europeans. Today, Lenape refers to the descendants of the many communities that spoke Munsee and Unami, dialects of Algonquian, one of the many families of languages spoken by all the coastal Native people from Canada to the Carolinas. The word Lenape means the original people in their language. The term Delaware is now used to refer to some Lenape people. As you can see, embedded in the lesson are audio pronunciations from enrolled members of Native nations featured in the lesson. Also included are definitions of key vocabulary words. Just north, we come to the ancestral homelands of the Mohican. The Mohican live near what is known today as the Hudson River. Today, they are called the Mohican. The Mohican spoke a coastal Algonquian language and shared many similar ways of life with the Lenape. In their language, they call themselves the Mahikonuk, people of the waters that are never still. In the fall of 1609, representatives from the Mohican people encountered Hudson's ship near present-day Albany and exchanged goods with them, one of which was fur. As we learned in the opening video, written accounts of the encounter along the Hudson River got the attention of wealthy Dutch merchants who soon after sent traders back to the northeastern Atlantic coast to capitalize on the supply of furs in the region. Just a few years later, in 1614, the Dutch built Fort Nassau, the first of several trading houses, in Mahican territory. Far from passively accepting whatever was offered, it was native preference that shaped the trade. To maintain successful trade transactions with native New York traders, the Dutch kept trading houses stocked full of supplies and goods that catered to native demands. This section of the lesson concludes with a chart showing native and Dutch views of exchange in order for students to compare what exchange meant to both groups. In the creation of this chart, we worked closely with native consultants to develop these enduring values. So I'm going to ask that you all take a few seconds to look over the chart. And in the chat, can you write what differences you notice between native and Dutch views of exchange? So how were native New Yorker and Dutch views of exchange different? You can write that in the chat. So we have community versus deal and profit, different sense of ownership, exchange was communitarian in the native view, individualistic in the Dutch view, collective versus individualistic, exchange related to power with the Dutch, a different concept of wealth. Dutch was the acquisition of wealth, native was community needs and growth. Wow, great comparisons. Money versus community wealth, giving thanks versus acquisition, bringing communities together versus profit making. Wonderful comparisons. Thank you for participating. Now that we've introduced the people of 17th century native New York, we ask students to use what they learned about exchange as they move to answer the next supporting question: how did the use of trade goods show differences in what people valued? The big ideas to be taken from this section are: the fur trade depended on establishing relationships based on native practices of exchange. Both native and Dutch people participated in trade to acquire what they desired and for survival. And what was traded and why reflects the values native people and the Dutch held. To trade with native people, the Dutch had to adapt to native protocols of exchange. In the early years of the fur trade relationships were mutually beneficial. Native people traded with the Dutch to get goods they wanted and valued, and the Dutch, who depended on native skills and knowledge of the land, were able to acquire furs and other goods and services needed to survive. As time went on, native people used trade to strengthen their influence, build alliances, and to remain in their homelands. So we're going to take a look at the flow of three particular trade goods: wampum, Dutch kettles, and beaver fur, to learn what the Lenape, Mahican, and Dutch wanted and why. Just a note, we will go into greater detail regarding each trade good in the upcoming slides. So on the top left, we learned that native people all over native New York valued shell beads called wampum at the time, and they still do. The Dutch traded European goods such as metal kettles for the highly valued wampum. As seen on the bottom center, the Dutch then traded wampum and goods like metal kettles with the Mahican for beaver furs and food. On the top right, we saw how the Mahican would then trade wampum with tribes further north for beaver furs. Although this lesson does not address the Haudenosaunee who lived further north, a link will be provided in the chat to the teacher resource guide on the Haudenosaunee. So next, we're going to take a closer look at the fur trade goods that flowed throughout native New York. For years prior to the 17th century fur trade, many native people in the Northeast used wampum in a variety of social, economic, and religious and political rituals. Wampum is a bead made from the purple rim of quahog clam shells and the inner spiral part of whelk shells. The shells were collected by Native people who lived along the coasts of Long Island, including the Uncochug and Shinnecock. Creating wampum beads took skill and time. Shells were ground and sanded to form cylindrical beads. They then drilled a hole through the center of each bead with a bow drill. Europeans introduced metal drills called mucks that sped up the wampum making process. Wampum beads were woven to make belts, collars, and various other adornments. Many of the items have symbolic designs. Strangers and friends exchanged wampum to build and maintain relationships. Native people still use wampum in ceremonies to pay respect and to record important events. For Native New Yorkers, a Dutch kettle was an incredible source of metal. A metal kettle served as a raw material from which a wide selection of Native implements and ornaments could be made. Kettles were a valuable source of raw material, something too valuable for cooking. As time went on, Dutch kettles replaced Native-produced pottery. Next, we're going to follow the journey of a Dutch kettle. In the lesson, we provide an interactive feature that allows students to rotate a 3D Dutch trade kettle in order to see how the metal was cut into specific sizes and shapes, then reworked into Native designs, ornaments, and tools. Students can also click on a number to learn more about what each cut metal piece was reworked into. Very interactive feature. Native New Yorkers transformed Dutch metal goods into tools and objects like the ones they already had, only better. Metal tools were stronger than stone tools, which improved Native life. For this next part, I'd like to ask the audience to participate in answering a question. We're going to do that by using an interactive poll. Take a look at this image of a cut metal object. To participate, just click on your choice to answer what you think this piece of metal from a Dutch trade kettle was reworked into. Was it A, a hole punch for leather goods, B, a funnel, or C, an ornamental tubular bead? So take a few seconds. You can make your guess now. All right, so let's see what the cut metal was used for. So it looks like a lot of different guesses, but a hole punch for leather goods has quite a bit of guesses, followed by an ornamental tubular bead. So let's see what the cut metal was used for. The correct answer was C, an ornamental tubular bead. These tubular beads, called tinkler cones, were hung on clothing or bags to make a jingling sound. As evident in this beautiful shoulder bag, metal from Dutch trade kettles weren't only used for utilitarian purposes. Reworked metal also shows a flourishing of Native creativity and complexity that required great technical skill and control. The last journey students will follow is that of a beaver fur. Native people had long hunted animals for their meat and fur for clothing. The well-developed hunting and trapping skills of Native hunters were essential to providing a steady supply of beaver fur in the fur trade. Furs were highly perishable. Before it began its long journey to Europe, the fur had to be cleaned and dried. The first step in processing furs was done by Native women, whose skills and labor were valuable commodities with which they could use to obtain what they needed. Beaver pelts were then transported to Europe, where they were made into beaver felt hats. These highly prized hats played a large role in reflecting one's social status. Symbols of wealth in Dutch society, beaver fur hats served to set apart those belonging to the burgeoning elite class, while profits from sales funded ships banks, industries, and commerce. As explored in this section of the lesson, goods and services were traded for different purposes. Many of the items sought after were influenced by different cultural value systems. The Dutch depended on native knowledge in order to survive and acquire wealth-generating goods. For native people, the Dutch were a source of raw materials that improved native life. Trade with the Dutch also allowed access to highly valued wampum beads. We've reached the last supporting question in our lesson. Applying what was explored in the previous sections on exchange and values, students examined sources that present the different cultural worldviews concerning land and how these differences contributed to misunderstandings regarding the meaning of the exchange that took place on Manhattan in 1626. This section begins by asking students to consider the significance of the Skagen letter, the earliest reference to the land exchange that took place on Manhattan in 1626. Peter Skagen, a representative for the Dutch West India Company, wrote a letter reporting of the purchase of Manhattan from native people. Upon reading this Dutch account of the land exchange, we find that a critical voice is missing, the native perspective. In fact, there is no record about the native people who participated in this exchange, nor their understanding of the trade from that time period. So once again, I'm going to ask for your participation. Taking into consideration that the Skagen letter does not include all voices involved in the land transaction, take a few seconds to jot down in the chat your thoughts on how the Skagen letter has shaped our understanding of the land exchange that took place on Manhattan in 1626. So tell us what you think. It's male-oriented. It follows our own present-day understanding of property. We view it through European cultural values. One-sided view. Letter was used as an absolute truth. It slanted the story to the perspective of the Dutch. Great observations. It names and prioritizes the perspective of the Dutch. Great. The letter mistakes the nature of the exchange that took place, reflecting only the individualistic private property perspective. The winners write the history. There was no exchange, only one perspective. Great observations. Not having the native voice make it seem like it was okay or approved by the native people. It leads to a misunderstanding. Thank you for participating. Wonderful observations. In this final supporting question, students are asked to annotate sources to identify native and Dutch views of land. Initially, Dutch traders had very little interest in native land. This would change once the Dutch West India Company was created in 1621. To keep the fur trade away from other European competitors, they brought more Dutch people to New York to settle. As Dutch populations grew, so did their desire for more land. For the Dutch, land was something that could be bought, sold, and privately owned. Native New Yorkers, while they understood the notion of sovereignty over a particular territory, did not view land as a commodity, nor could it be individually owned. As a result, in the early years of Native and Dutch trade, Native groups would exchange land, but in their minds were allowing only the shared use of lands. The infamous purchase of Manhattan Island loses some of its impact as a great real estate deal when one considers that the Native people of the area probably never intended to give it up, but rather to lease it for Dutch use while they maintained sovereignty over it and continued to occupy it. At this point in the inquiry, students have examined sources that demonstrate the differences in value systems and the importance of exchange in establishing and maintaining relationships in Native societies. To support students' building of evidence-based arguments to answer the compelling question, did Native people really sell Manhattan? This inquiry features an interactive online news article generator called the Independent Observer. Here, students can build a news article to construct a written argument about the compelling question. After selecting a pre-designed template, students determine which featured sources from the inquiry best support their argument. They can then write captions, quotations, headlines, body text, and bylines in the construction of their news article. This concludes my section of today's lesson walkthrough. Thank you so much for participating and for adding your voices to the conversation. I'm now going to turn it back to Johanna, who will address contemporary connections and sharing Native New Yorkers today.
Thank you, Myra. That was wonderful. So we conclude this lesson with a focus on contemporary Native New Yorkers. As Ed Shoopman noted in last week's presentation, most textbooks and curricula today still present Native Americans in the past. Few stories feature 21st century Native lives. Too few young students are not aware that the descendants of the people who engaged with the Dutch in the early 17th century continue to call New York home. As Myra mentioned, we consulted with several Native people in the creation of this lesson. We wanted students to see the faces of people with whom we worked and young Native children today. We are ever mindful that perception plays a large role in how students think about and understand Native history and culture. Seeing people in everyday clothing and engaging in cultural activities enables students to change their perceptions of Native people as only living in the past. Part of the work that we do at this museum is helping teachers to hear from and ultimately appreciate Native voices and cultural values that have been silenced for so long. Creating opportunities for dialogue and raising awareness of complex history and contemporary Native realities and bringing light to our shared history can't happen without you. We recognize that your role of leadership in the classroom with children, with and as parents, and with your colleagues is critical to our own healing and reconciliation in this country. I believe that the role of education is not only to learn about history, science, or math, but to really to recognize the multitude of ways of seeing the world, of inspiring a love of learning and finding better ways to live together equitably. It's a work in progress, and it comes daily from both small individual acts and larger coordinated efforts. So we are really grateful for the work that you do each and every day to inspire and teach our next generation. So in this lesson, we feature three communities. We have Winona Vele, who's proudly wearing her regalia at the annual Mohican Powwow in Wisconsin in 2019. New York City resident George Stonefish, who's Delaware and Ottawa, and Curtis Zuniga, who is the Director of Cultural Resources for the Delaware Tribe of Indians based in Oklahoma. So showing Native people as present-day members of communities that continue to strive to keep their cultures alive and vibrant works to advance our museum's vision statement. Equity and social justice for the Native people of the Western Hemisphere through education, inspiration, and empowerment. We thank you so much for joining our program today and hope that you will take more time to explore our lessons and to use them with your students. Please join our mailing list if you have not already done so, so that you might receive communication from us about upcoming programs.
Thank you, Myra and Johanna, for walking us through this fantastic new digital lesson. And with that, we've concluded our Native New York in Your Classroom webinar series. Recordings of all four webinars will be available on the museum's YouTube channel in the coming weeks. and we'll be posting a link to our YouTube channel in the chat. We'll also be posting a link in the chat to where you can learn more about the National Museum of the American Indians Native Knowledge 360 initiative. This is an initiative that provides educators and students with new perspectives on Native American history and cultures. On this website, you can find other online classroom lessons in addition to the one you saw today, guided student programs, and other teacher training opportunities like the one you participated in today. Thank you all for joining us.